fewer seats than last week because last week we have some who stayed here after the wedding. So I invite for those who still haven't married yet. We want a lot of good news of this church so that our seats will be filled up. And today we'd like to welcome Mrs. Grabban. So from Miss to Mrs. Grabban this morning. And Mr. B. During this time, Nong Tan, my daughter, goes for an internship and she goes back home quite late sometimes. Hun Dong and myself have to wait. There is a new restaurant selling Japanese food, and sometimes we go and wait there because it has a nice air conditioning system. And one day when we were sitting there, there was one guy who was drunk. He drank a lot and he started to talk. So from what I learned from him is that even though he was drunk, but what he said is actually true and made me go back home and study on what he was talking about. He was asking the shop owner, do you have a song from VCR? He said that he wanted to listen to one song. So the shop owner actually turned on that song for him, CCR, called Stop the Rain. And that drunk guy was saying, stop the rain doesn't mean asking for anybody who is stopping the rain, but at that time, the United States was bombing. And so they were bombing us a lot so that it looks like the rain. So after listening to CCR, Peter, Paul, and Mary, or Bob Dylan, Where Have All the Flowers Gone, or other similar songs. These songs, I went back home and researched, did some research. It's actually related to anti-ing the war. I was actually listening to Stop the Rain for tens of years, but I've never known that it was actually related to war. The lyrics that we sing the song, sometimes you don't understand the meaning or the intention of the songwriter. So once you start to listen repeatedly, something good might came out of that lyric, as I was learning this lesson from the drunken guy. Many times when you read a lot of the Bible verses, you read it over and over again, then something actually slipped out from the scripture, just like the life of David, a giant killer. We learn that the giant will not be away from your life. A giant will always be present in your life. But with our God's goodness, we learned that when I was talking about this giant killer series, when I said, our God is good, you would say, all the time. And all the time, our God is good. 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 All the time. All the time. This happens to David's life. Because many times we can see that from 1 Samuel 14 through 19, David won over the giant. The people loved David. The daughter of King Saul loved David. But sometimes life did not go according to the way we expected. And I want to share with you, when I was in high school, when I was trying to play guitar, you have to actually figure out the chord yourself. There was no online resource to help you. So I would play on the cassette tape and keep on replaying and replaying so that I could figure out the chord. The school that I went to, The principal of my school is actually what we call super religious. Every Tuesday and every Friday, there will be making merit. And he will invite the famous monk to teach the students. So for me, who was Christian, I felt uneasy, because if you are not Buddhism, you would be in a separate room. I have a close friend named Anucha. He's a Muslim and I'm a Christian. So for in every week, every month, when they called these Buddhism students, whenever there is this special session, all who are not Buddhism have to be separated. So me and Anucha are getting close and close together. So it's like a tradition for the Thai kids in my days, that when you are close to someone, you are not calling them by their own name, but you're calling them by their father's name. Me and Kun Anucha got very, very close, so that we share a lot of things. And we also share not just teasing one another, but we also share about religion. I share how the Muslim would pray. So once we talked, he seemed that he did not understand how Christian is, so I invited him to church. I know that the Muslim does not eat pork, but I bought pork dumpling and I told him that it's actually a fish dumpling. So I invited him home, we played guitar, and then I asked him to have this dumpling. Anucha actually ate a pork dumpling as I told him that it was a fish dumpling, because I was mad at him by the way that he criticized Christianity. So he was eating with joy. So after we talked in hours, nothing happened. He didn't know until I called him by his father's name. Brother, I'm sorry, but what you just ate is actually pork dumpling. I still remember that picture that I see. His face turned white and his lips were swollen. I don't know what happened. It was like he felt that he was very sick. He said, "Didn't you know?" I said, "I do, but I want to know what would happen. But why didn't you become like this once you ate?" And he was pausing for a moment. This is my close friend when I was in high school. I have another close friend who is Chinese, selling dumpling in Tonglo area. This person has to help his dad to sell this dumpling since 1 o'clock, 1 a.m. every day. So whenever he goes to school, he would sleep. He would be very sleepy. But he would always get a good grade all the time. So I wanted to check how he is studying. When he was helping his dad preparing this dumpling, Does he read any book? Does he do any homework? He always sleep. And I was surprised because he didn't read anything while he was helping his dad. In the United Kingdom, there is a competition asking people to send in the best definition of the word friend or friendship. Friend is the one who comes in when the whole world has gone out. This is the definition that has won this competition. Who is that person who stands beside you when others have left you? Who is that person who stands beside you when you have no one else? And that person can know whenever your thoughts are not a good thoughts maybe about them, but they can still live with that and still stand beside you. friend of a giant killer that we're going to study today. It's quite a strange kind of thing. Let's read from Psalm 23. David has written this chapter, and there is a phrase that I think it is from his heart. Psalm chapter 23. During the first few verses, it seems that everything is quite good. The Lord is my shepherd, I lack nothing. But once you read through to verse 5, in verse 4 and 5, I think this is actually probably the most part of David's life. For the most part of his life, he was facing Saul. He was facing hatred without any reason. There are many people who might have loved him, but comparing him with Saul, and Saul wanted to kill David. David knows that he will become a king instead of Saul, since he was young, but the time that he has to serve Saul was very long. Psalm 23, verse 45. Even though I walk through the darkest valley, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. Preparing what? A table. Once we read through, it seems that there are problems when he was walking in his life. In verse 4, I walk through the darkest valley. Have you ever been that way? Walking through a super dark valley, you might have lost your job. You might have a lot more expenses than what you earn. You're having family problems, you're having health problems. You go see a doctor, the doctor said, please sit down. This is a little bit of a bad news. It seems that everything goes well until one day something happened. Until one day the doctor would come and tell you, whatever you do, be prepared. You don't have that much time. You're trying to earn a lot of money, making a lot of income, preparing for something, until one day you finally understand that that money cannot be traded for a good health. David can win over everything, but he said here that he is walking through the darkest valley. I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. It seemed that David has a lot of enemies, but what has he done wrong? Has he, when he had gone out and killed the giant, what has he done wrong? Why does he have to face a lot of hatred? If he were to become the new leader. We've been studying that the first leader happened because the Jewish needs to have a king so that they can be just like other countries. So what they did is that they chose from a physical properties, they have chosen Saul for his character, for his looks. When Samuel asked God what he should do, but God said that just let them be. They did not denying me. So God has prepared a way to solve this issue by choosing a very small young boy. And even the father of this boy did not believe that he could be the one. Brothers and sisters, in David's life, the lesson is this. We can look for love or hatred. We can look for an enemy or a true friend. We can know that a true friend of a giant killer. Jonathan, how is this person like? How is this person who can be called a friend of a giant killer? Jonathan is the son of the king, who can actually be succeeding the throne, but he has chosen a friend instead of a throne. Instead of power. many times we ask ourselves, is it fair in this world? Is this world fair to you? Is this world cruel? I know that there's no justice. If you think that when you do one thing, you're expecting to get something in return, it's not always that way. David is trying so hard to be good. You might have tried so hard to do good things, but a giant will always be present in your life, will always come. So let's look at a character of a friend, a giant killer. What is his character? A friend who is willing to sacrifice, a friend who is willing to give. You can give and not take. When you go and see a beggar, you can just give them some coins that you have. You can give without love, but you cannot love without giving. So our first lesson is in 1 Samuel chapter 18, verse 1 through 4. After David had finished talking with Saul, Jonathan became one in spirit with David, and he loved him as himself. From that day, Saul kept David with him and did not let him return home to his family. And Jonathan made a covenant with David because he loved him as himself. Jonathan took off the robe he was wearing and gave it to David, along with his tunic, and even his sword, his bow, and his belt. Branding. Branding identity is what you will always see when you watch TV or watching advertisement. And for Thailand, we have read a lot from the news. But there's one country song company that has actually creating there a very strong branding identity. It's called Arsiam. The branding of the Jewish at the time is actually their clothing. How they wear is actually their branding. Remember when Joseph, his clothes was torn off. So the clothing is kind of like labeling people. The clothing of the son of the king is actually a special robe. Might have been different. The belt can be filled with food, some armor. And as we read verse 1 through 4, there are a lot of things that Jonathan has given to David, and the scripture has noted the love, agape, a few times. Jonathan took off the robe, his tunic, his sword, his bow, and his belt. The sword of a soldier is one thing, the sword of a general is one thing, the sword of the king is another thing, and the sword of a prince, an heir to the throne, is another thing. That's what Jonathan has given to David. The bow is a different kind than what others were having. What is Jonathan giving to David? What is this scripture telling us? Has there ever been anybody who came into your life and has given many things? They're willing to sacrifice. Jonathan was receiving these, and that's, he has given what he has received to David. As we read in John 3:16, for God so loved the world. We cannot say that we love the church without giving anything back to the church. We have to love so much that you are willing to sacrifice, willing to give something out. We have to love enough, just like Jonathan, that he was giving. those who had to leave this town. And from what we heard is that the father of this person has a close friend, and a father's close friend passed away. If you love someone, you would be willing to sacrifice something. There is a foundation called Make-A-Wish who would go to different countries and try to help the kids who had cancer. If that kid would ask to be seated with the sit in a president's chair, they would do it for them. And there was one boy named John, he was 6 years old. He had cancer. And they were reading. They thought that this boy might have asked to play with the dolphins or to go to Disneyland or something else, but this boy said that at his school, would like to have a special playground. He saw this playground in a department store with some rock climbing. And he's never seen it anywhere else. He would like that to be constructed at his school. So he asked Make-A-Wish that if my school can have that, then I can pass away peacefully. They were surprised because they have never seen any kid who was asking for something for other people. This boy is a very special boy. You know, from that day on, what this kid has done is actually benefiting to generations to come. Proverbs 27, verse 17. Proverbs 27, verse 17. As iron sharpens iron, so one person sharpens another. A friend can sharpen a friend. We have one of the brothers named Leng, or it means iron in English. We know the property of an iron. Only an iron can sharpen an iron. Proverbs 27, verse 17. As iron sharpens iron, so one person sharpens another. A friend can change another friend's life. In John 15, verse 15, I no longer call you servants, because a servant does not know his master's business. Instead, I have called you friends, for everything that I learned from my father I have made known to you. Wants to change the relationship from servant to friend. Our God, who is the most powerful, who has full authority, this God is saying, I no longer call you servants. Because a servant does not know his master's business. Has nothing to hide. John chapter in John chapter 1. I have prepared this lesson from John chapter 1 for on when John said, John is pointing to Jesus. Are you the one who is pointing to your friend, Jesus? Go to him. Don't miss church. Be focused. John is pointing to Jesus Christ. He made the way. When Jesus was asked who he is, he said, come and see. See his life. This is the true friend. Has to be sincere. Has to be able to understand your life. Understand who you are. I will no longer call you servants. I have called you friends. Whatever that was made known to me, made known to you. Galatians chapter 6, verse 2. Carry each other's burden, and in this way you will fulfill the law of Christ. Sometimes we do not consider ourselves as a burden until something came into your life. And suddenly you realize that you might have been a burden. I've talking to one of the brothers when one day a doctor said, please sit down. I have something to tell you. There's also another friend of his who said, we can do it. At the time he said, I did not have anyone. I almost fell down. Dying is better than living in pain. Who do you think of when something like this happens to your life? John chapter 11, verse 5. That friend of yours would think of you during times of hardship. Now Jesus loved Martha and her sister and Lazarus. Jesus loved this family. It seems that this family is a friend of him. Jesus, in verse 9, Jesus answered, are there not 12 hours of daylight? Anyone who walks in the daytime will not stumble, for they see by this world's light. Jesus is trying to say that he is the light, but the friend did not understand. In John chapter 11, verse 35, it's the shortest verse in the Bible. John 11, verse 35, Jesus wept. Why did Jesus seem quite emotional? Why did he cry? Probably many times he might have thought that a friend should understand his life more. They should have understood that if Jesus stayed there, no matter what happens, everything can be solved. But didn't he cry because Lazarus died? Or didn't he cry because a friend did not understand that he could help? Jonathan might have known, I don't know, that from that moment on, David would need to use all these things that he had given to him. Two are better than one, because they have a good return for their labor. If either of them falls down, one can help the other up. But pity anyone who falls and has no one to help them up. Brothers and sisters, 6 months have passed for 2014, and I tell you that it is necessary that you have one person, anybody, who is a true friend in spirit, who can open your heart, who cares about you, who is able to take the good side and the bad side of you. I want us to consider who that person is. Pray about this. Worry that if you don't see this person in church, in the congregation, you would have to make a call. That you have to check how they are and get them back to church. Second point. A friend of a giant protect him. Spending time standing beside him. Father Saul is looking for a chance to kill you. Be on your guard tomorrow morning. Go into hiding and stay there. I will go out and stand with my father in the field where you are. I'll speak to him about you, and I will tell you what I find out. Jonathan spoke well of David to Saul his father and said to him, let not the king do wrong to his servant David. He has not wronged you, and what he has done has benefited you greatly. He took his life in his hands when he killed the Philistine. The Lord won great victory for all Israel, and you saw it and were glad. Why then did you wrong to an innocent man like David by killing him for no reason? When we read through the Bible, the one verse that is telling us that David and Jonathan can become a friend is because they share the same God. Saul told his son that he would kill David. What did Jonathan get by doing this? Verse 1 and 5. The relationship between a father and a son. Would it still stay there? What was his benefit? He's trying to tell his father not to hurt this person. A father might have said, if I don't kill this guy, then how would you be able to become king? Sometimes you have to choose whatever is right than what you like. Choose God rather than your own. Jonathan is that person who is brave enough to ask his father, telling him that David has not done anything wrong. Life is that way. Do not think that when you do good things, when you did the right thing, everybody would have to love you. This is not the way the world works. And this story in the Bible is still true today. There will be many giants, and only a few people will stand beside you in times like this. This world and the Holy Spirit do not walk in the same way. to 1 Samuel chapter 20, verse 41 and 42. There is the word, the term that was written, holy kiss, as we read from Rome, chapter 6, verse 16. Romans 16. The holy kiss, Jewish kiss. First Samuel chapter 20, verse 41 and 42. After the boy had gone, David got up from the south side of the stone and bowed down before Jonathan three times with his face to the ground. Then they kissed each other and wept together, but David wept the most. Jonathan said to David, "Go in peace, for we have sworn friendship with each other in the name of the Lord, saying, 'The Lord is witness between you and me, and between your descendants and my descendants forever.'" Then David left, and Jonathan went back to the town. To take you back to the story between these two. How, under what circumstances would a man cry? Wept together, but David wept the most. Sometimes things happen and you think that you cannot move forward. Don't have enough strength. And a man might have cried. And for Thai tradition, it seemed that a guy would have to be strong. They cannot express their weakness by crying. We see that from verse 41 and 42, they opened their hearts. They have a friendship. Every Wednesday, one person would call me and we would talk about how each other is like, and that person might have confessed his sin, and me too. And this person, he has nothing to hide. He opened and he shared what his life was like, what has happened in his life. And as I listened, I said, when you are telling me, sharing with me all these, aren't you afraid that I would tell others? He said, "No, I'm not afraid, because I know that you are a true friend." 2 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 12. Second Corinthians 6, verse 12 to 15. Paul told them to open their hearts. "We're not withholding our affection from you, but you are withholding yours from us. As a fair exchange, I speak as to my children, open wide your hearts also. Do not be yoked together with unbelievers. For what do righteousness and wickedness have in common? Or what fellowship can light have with darkness? What harmony is there between Christ and Belial? Or what does a believer have in common with an unbeliever?" This goes beyond a partnership, a company partnership, or business partnership, but this goes into an eternal partnership. I have told you many times that during 1 year, I always love to work with the Africans, spending time with them. There's one person who shared with me, you don't know how it is like to be black. I said, I do. So he would lift up his arm and compare it with mine and said, no, you don't. There is an athlete, a baseball player named Jackie Robinson. He was one of the first African American who is very, very talented. But during that time, there was a racial discrimination that was going on, and he was mocked. So once he was going down, he was at the second base, and people were yelling from the stage, cursing him. Until his friend named P.B. Reese, who is white, told Coach, please stop. Ask for a timeout. Reese walked to the second base. He was white, and his friend has a black skin. So once he got there, he hugged his friend. Jackie Robinson He said, you are right. The stage was actually getting quiet, for they were seeing two men with a different skin color was hugging one another and said, we can fight. We can do it. And the stage has gone quiet from that moment. Brothers and sisters, is there anyone in your life who is really protecting you? Don't hate that person if they're trying to call you, asking how you are. Don't hate them if they ever challenge you spiritually. Don't be angry with them if they call you and ask you to go to a Bible school, go to a Bible class, go to a Bible camp. Don't be angry at them when they're asking you how your faith is like. But know and try to seek for a friend just like Jonathan. You might not have a lot, but only one is enough. Jesus Christ said that He is a friend. He is a true friend who can sacrifice His life to you. So let me take you to this video, and then that ends my lesson this morning. This is the 10th story of the animals. And don't forget, they're just animals. They did not see that they would get along. What about these two? This even look very impossible. Our God is really powerful. Unbelievable that they could become friends. They're just animals. to see that even though they are totally different, they can still become friends. Brothers and sisters, these, they're just animals, but our God wants to be your friend. He has all the power and authority, but He sacrificed His life for you. He wants to tell you to do the same thing as what Jonathan has done, has given to David. So I'd like to leave this lesson with you that in the one life that we have, there should be someone who actually protects you and sacrifice that person's life for you, just like Jonathan has sacrificed for David. Jesus Christ has done the very same thing to your life. We are sinners. We have to be punished. But Jesus is saying that they are my friend. I will die for them on the cross. Therefore, Jesus Christ's death, and as we take part in the communion, this tells us clearly that there is no greater love. There's no greater love than when one person is sacrificing the life for his friend. God loves us so much. Let us show our love to others. What we have seen from the example is just animal. Different species, different race. We can be the same way. Protect one another in spirit, because our God is good. God is good all the time, and all the time our God is good. May our Lord be with you this week, so that you can become Jonathan of someone's life this week. Seek for that person, or choose someone, go and tell them and be with them, spending time with them. Let them know how much you love them. Let our church be like that. Let us spend time with one another. Don't let anyone get lost along the way. Don't let, when you see that someone is missing, don't let yourself become just that person who don't know. Don't be just a social club. Don't just be a club where you come every Sunday, but let it be a relationship that is more than that. Protect one another. May your God be with you.